Hello, I'm Carly McAvoy, and today I'm talking about graphing an equation on a coordinate system. This is part one of three, because there's a lot of information to take in. If I ask you to graph an equation, that means I want you to draw a line on a coordinate system that represents the solutions of that equation. A graph is a representation of the solutions. And we call this a linear equation because when you graph those solutions, they form a line. So we could see in another video that there's an infinite number of solutions to this. But we're just going to choose three of those and then plot them on the graph. So the first one is, what if x was 0? What would y be? And you might be able to use a cover-up method on that. In other words, x is 0, that just makes that go away. Can you see that y would have to be 3? If you can do that, you save yourself some time. If x was 0, then y would have to be 3. You can plug it in, excuse me, or cover up and see it. What if x was 1? Well, if x was 1, what would y have to be to give us 3? Hopefully you could do that in your head. But you don't have to do it in your head. You can plug in the value that you're given and then solve for the unknown. And that tells us that if x was 1, y is 2. I'm doing a very simple example. We'll go to some harder ones, but because I want you to get the idea of what we're doing. We're saying, what's the ordered pair? If x is a 0, what's its partner that makes this true? And finally, what if y is 0? Well, again, by the cover-up method, you could just cover up the y, because if that's 0, it's gone, and x is 3. So there's another ordered pair, and we could do that again, plug it in if you don't want to use the cover-up method, and then x is just 3. That gives us our three ordered pairs. Now, if we did this correctly, when we plot our three points, they should form a line. Starting at the origin, and you can number these lines quickly if you want. Sometimes I don't number them until I see how far I'm going out. Here I don't have any negatives, all positives, only to 3. So I just numbered up to 3. 0, 3. Well, starting at the origin, I don't go left or right because I have 0, but I go up to 3. And then I have 1, 2. So I go 1 to the right and 2 up. And 3, 0, 3 to the right, and then I don't go up or down. Now I've got three points, and they do form a line. But when I draw my graph, I connect up the three points. I use a straight edge because I don't want to be sloppy in my work. And when I connect those points up, I don't stop at those points. I go through the points, and I actually put an arrow on each end. Because what I'm suggesting here is that I showed three points out of an infinite number. In fact, what this line is every point on this line would make this equation true. I'll show you. Here's a point that's on this line. What is this point? 2, 1. 2 plus 1. Yes, that does equal 3. Here's a point on the line. What is this point? 4, negative 1. 4 plus negative 1 would be 3. That's another one. What about this one? Negative 1, 4. Negative 1 plus 4 would also be 3. I chose three of the points, but there's an infinite number. Every point on this line makes that equation true. That's an important concept to get through your head. What is this picture? It's a picture of these solutions. Let's look at this one right here. This one is 1 half, 2 and a half. 1 half plus 2 and a half, yep, that makes 3. So every point on that line is a solution to my equation. When I ask you, when I say what a graph is, the graph of a linear equation is a line that contains all of the solutions to that equation. That's what a graph of a linear equation is. It's a linear equation because our solutions form a line. Okay, let's look at another one. Sometimes, instead of writing the ordered pairs like we did up here, you'll see that people write the ordered pairs in a table form. And this is kind of nicer because you can see the x and the y. So this equation is in a different format. We'll talk more about the formats later, but you can see the difference is the x and the y were together here, and the y is by itself here. When it's in this format with the y by itself, it seems easier to me to plug in values for x. So I didn't choose any values for y, I just chose values for x. I chose these randomly. I could have chosen negative 17, 45, and 252. Every number in the universe has a mate, okay, for this equation. But I don't want to graph those numbers, whatever I just said. I want to graph smaller numbers, so I picked small numbers that were easy to work with. Okay, so for the first one, if x is 0, you're going to get 2 times 0 minus 1, and that's going to mean that y is negative 1. So that's the ordered pair 0, negative 1 when I get ready to graph it. In fact, I could graph that now. If x is 0, I don't go left or right, but I go down 1. There's that first point. Okay, second point, what if x is 1? Well, I would get y equals 2 times 1, and I get 2 minus 1, y would be 1. So if x was 1, y would also be 1. Okay, now those two points form a line. Why don't we just stop there? Well, you could have made a mistake because any two points make a line. If my second point was over here, it would have made a line. If my second point was over there, it would have made a line to the first one. But the third point makes sure that you line up with the first two. That's why it's good mojo to do a third point. Then you know that all three fall in line. Okay, so if x is negative 1, 2 times negative 1 is negative 2, and y is negative 3. So my point here is negative 1, negative 3. From the origin, negative 1 and negative 3. And now I can feel good about that, like, hey, those did line up. Lined up, and then I can make a line going through the points, passing beyond the points, and putting arrows to suggest, yes, these are the three points that I chose, but it goes forever in either direction, and it never ends. So if you were on doing an assignment or a test, and you chose three different points, it wouldn't matter because your final line is going to be the same line passing through at the same places here. It's going to look the same even though you picked three different points. But this is a very abstract concept, like this equation and graphing it, and it's like, why in the world will we ever do this? And so I want to think about a real-life scenario that could be associated with this equation. When you look at this equation, this number at the end suggests some kind of starting point, and then this suggests a change that's happening. So for this equation, you could say, like, this person started $1 in debt, but gained $2 every day after that. Because it's a negative, that means they started in the hole, but then they gained $2 after that every time. Okay, so you could start off, oh, I started off a game at zero, but the very first thing that happened to me was I went one in the hole. So now I started gaining two every time after that. So this is your starting point for when you start keeping a record, right? I started in the negative 1, but I gained 2 per game after that. Or I started at negative 1 and I gained $2 per day after that. I started in the hole by negative 1, but I gained, you know, 2 friends every day after that or whatever. I don't know. So all I had was one enemy here and then I gained, I don't know. But so that's a real life situation that could be associated with that. And so let's talk about a real-life situation that could be associated with our third problem, negative 3x plus 5. What this one suggests is that you started off with something. You started off with 5, and then you began to lose 3 per day, because this number tells you a starting point, and this number tells you a change that's occurring periodically. It could be over the day or the month or the hour or the second or the minute or whatever, but a change is happening, okay? So this could be like, I started off with 5 pencils, but then I started losing 3 per day. Or I started off with $5, and then I started losing 3 per month, or whatever. So this is a starting point, and this is a rate of change. Whatever's changing for you, you're losing something. That's what these equations could mean, okay? So in this equation, you started off in the hole, but you're gaining every day or every month. And so do you see how this equation goes up? Because this is a good thing. This rate of change for this one is a positive, which means, yes, I'm getting more and more and more as time goes on. What do you think is going to happen to this equation? Well, this equation is going to start at 5, but it's going to start going down, because in this equation, you're losing something every day or every hour or every minute or per person or whatever. Whatever that X happens to be, that represents a loss. And so we're going down when we graph that. And that becomes important to think about later. Okay, I wanted to give you some real life scenarios because it's good to associate these abstract things with, what does it even mean? What is the real life that could go with this? Okay, if X is 0, then 3 times 0 is just 0, so Y is 5. Every time it's in this format and you say X is 0, you could use the cover-up method. Because negative 3 times 0, yes, that's going to go away, and Y is 5. 0, 5. We don't go left or right, but we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No surprise that that number at the end is where we always start. That's always a starting point. In real life, if this was our equation, that would be our starting point. That's our starting point here, negative 1. That's where we were, right? We always pass that point because that's the starting point. That's what makes sense. Okay. Then I have negative 3 times 1 plus 5. And Y equals 2. So I have the point 1, 2. So you can see that our line is going to be going down. We're losing. This person's losing 3 per day. Boom. 3. Whatever. 3 per hour. I don't know. All right. Then we have the, what if it was 2? And I would have negative 6 plus 5 is negative 1. So if X was 2, Y would be negative 1. So I do have 3 points that line up. And I then am going to connect those. And I'm going to extend through them and draw arrows to suggest that I am just showing one little tiny part of a much bigger equation. All right, that's graphing equations part 1. We'll see you next time.